Richard Sullivan.
I'm at a loss to maintain my secrecy.
You're scrutinizing our books.
I'll help him.
I actually uploaded an app today on my cell phone, which is the first time I've done that.
Oh, okay, there you go.
Yeah.
I live in Maine.
Yeah, right, yeah. Patrick O'Reilly's at your age.
Molly's in love.
Danny would have been high.
Yeah, she has a small
laptop.
She says, so comparison.
Hey,
That's my business.
Hello. I'd like to bring the meeting to order. Supposed to be 6 o'clock, but we're running a little bit behind. Workshop of the Scarborough Town Council and the Scarborough School Board on the audit of finances for both.
I think we could probably turn it right over to Christian Smith, who's going to present to both bodies the financial audits for the period ending June 30, 2013.
All right, thank you. Hi, I am Christian Smith. I'm a director at MacPage LLC, your audit firm. We work out of South Portland, Maine. My goal here tonight is to give you an overview of the financial statements, give you a brief overview of the audit, kind of give you a little bit of an understanding of what an audit's about. And if you have questions, hopefully I can answer them for you. I handed out some slides that you can just kind of flip through along with me. We'll look a little bit at the financial statements as well. If you have those in front of you, we could look at a couple of pages there, but we're probably not going to dig too much into details. But I always like to start off to make sure people understand what the relationship is with the auditors. We are independent auditors. We do work for you. We work for the board. We work for the town council. We work with management to perform the audit. But ultimately, the financial statements, internal controls, those are the responsibility of management. You've hired us to look at the financial results and report on the financial results and express an opinion on the financial statements. You look for our opinion to provide you with assurance that the financial statements are presented in accordance with generally accepted accounting principles. And in both cases, both for the town and for the school department, we've issued what we call an unmodified opinion, which is a clean opinion. So that's the highest level of assurance we can give, which means the financial statements contain all of the required elements and disclosures. The numbers are accurate in compliance with generally accepted accounting principles. Next slide just kind of shows you all of the different reports that we issue. First one we call, technically it's the SAS 114 letter, which is the governance letter. So that's just a letter where we would outline if there were any significant changes in accounting policies, accounting practices, if there were any disagreements with management in terms of application of accounting practices, it would be highlighted in that letter. That letter is the standard letter. There's no issues encountered as part of the audit, no disagreements with respect to accounting practices. We also issue a separate management letter, one for the town, one for the school department. I'll briefly touch on those as well. We're also required to do an audit of compliance with federal grant requirements. So the town receives federal grant money, the school receives federal grant money. There's a whole separate set of standards that we have to follow and test the grant money to ensure that they're in compliance with the federal requirements. This year, we tested the HIDA grant, which is a town grant. There were no compliance findings, no items to report with respect to that testing. We also are required to report to the state auditor. A procedural form that kind of outlines our procedures and if there were any issues with the audit, the state auditor, there were no issues there. With respect to the school department, we have to reconcile the upload of the school's accounting to the MEDM system and ensure that that is accurate, as well as issue a report whether or not the school complies with the Maine School Finance Act. So we've issued those reports as well. No findings there either. I'm going to jump right into the management letter comments. Just to give you an overview, there's actually, when we write a management letter comment, we have to look at the severity and the potential for a financial statement misstatement. So there are three different levels. The highest level would be a material weakness. The next highest level is what's called a significant deficiency. The lowest level is what's called a control deficiency, or kind of a best practices recommendation. So we have to use judgment to identify and assess the severity of each one. With respect to the town, we had one comment this year, and it's, you know, the lowest level, best practices recommendation. We reviewed the procedures for monitoring inventory at the Public Works Department. They took over management of the inventory system again this year, so we have some recommendations there in terms of improving procedures and controls in that area. And they've come up with a response, and certainly we can work with them on developing different procedures if we need to. Again, there was a comment last year regarding the fixed assets. That has been resolved and corrected, so, you know, we do look, see that the prior year recommendations are corrected and going forward. So that's been resolved, so that's not been, has not been repeated.
I'll make certain that members of council are provided a copy of our management response to the control deficiency or the best practice recommendation Christian just mentioned. I'm eminently confident that this issue will not be back as a suggestion at the next audit. Mike Shaw has, I think, things well in control and well underway to satisfy this concern already. But I'll provide you the formal, official written response so you can see it for yourself.
With respect to the school department, we had four best practices recommendations there as well, all of which had to do with the student activity funds that the school is responsible for overseeing. You know, we do commonly have some comments in this area from time to time. These are different comments than what we had in the prior year regarding just some following some policies, documentation of approvals, and some deficit funds at the high school and the Wentworth student activity funds. You know, really pretty not significant in nature, but when we find an item, we do like to report it to management, and that way you're aware of it and can look into it. And the comments that we had from the prior year have also been taken care of, so none of these are repeat comments from the prior year.
We actually usually have to respond to the state DOE when we get a finding so that we can give them some sort of an action plan, and we have some notes on that, which, Tom, if you like, I can share that with you to disseminate that. Just, you know, basically some of the things we're working on in the controls area. I'll make sure that I get you a copy of that.
Great, thank you. And with the student activity funds as well, it's not actually the school's money to spend. It's the money that's raised by the kids that they administer. So, you know, in terms of, you know, if you're thinking about it in terms of does it affect the town or the town's operations or the school departments, it's really outside of the school department, but they're responsible for overseeing it. If you will, we could go right into the financial statements. So I've provided you with a slide that just gives you an overview of what's in the financial statements. You know, if you have the financial statements here, we could look at a couple of pages, but, you know, again, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on them. So the town has received the Award of Excellence in Financial Reporting for, I think this is the eighth year, published a comprehensive annual financial report. It provides full disclosure, full transparency to the taxpayers. It provides more information than is required in a more than just the basic information that's required in a GAAP financial statement. So within the report, there's a transmittal letter, which is pages 1 through 10. That kind of gives people an overview of, about the town of Scarborough, what the economics of the town is like. You know, our opinion, which is on pages 17 and 19, that's, you know, again, that's an unmodified or a clean opinion, so that's what you look to achieve from your audit firm. And actually, our opinion is on the top of page 18, if you're actually looking for it. And basically, as I said, it states that the financial statements have been fairly presented. Management's discussion and analysis is pages 23 through 35, so this provides the reader with a summary so they can have a basic understanding as to how the town is doing, how did the year go. So the idea is that you can read those 13 or 14 pages, have a complete understanding as to the finances of the town without having to read the full report. It's definitely in a lot more, I think, reader-friendly format. It's a summary of the results for the year. I also need to point out, so within these financial statements, there actually are three different sets of accounting. There's three different levels of accounting. What's called the government-wide financial statement shows up on pages 39 and 40.
Just if I could, please take Christian's recommendation, those 10 pages, particularly for the new counselors, are really designed for the novice to read and understand, and I don't mean that at all disparagingly. It's just a really good way of getting a strong sense of what our financial position is and some of the trends that we need to be aware of. So I'd encourage you to spend time to thumb through those pages.
Can I just say that last year, as a new counselor, that's amazing, the amount of information that's in that, condensed into that, and it's just commendable what you've managed to put together for people like us that are just coming into it and need that explanation. So it's really, it's an amazing job again.
Yeah, and definitely, I didn't make mention, I should make mention of that, the finance department actually does prepare, they prepare the financial statements, they prepare the management discussion and analysis. I mean, we do assist with it in some portions of it, but the preparation, you know, is handled by Ruth and her department, so.
Excellent job, Ruth.
I just told it's a great report. I also have a great thing to make.
It is, and for people, again, like us, for last year, being new, just an incredible tool to have and to be able to reference.
Right.
We need to sort of walk through the great job.
So, the government-wide financial statements on pages 39 and 40. 39 is what's called the statement of net position, your balance sheet. This has been designed to look like a business. So this you know, this is not how you keep your day-to-day books. This, you know, you'll see that there's capital assets under assets of $25 million and $101 million. So, under full accrual accounting, assets are capitalized and depreciated. On the budgetary basis, which is how you keep your books, if you buy a police cruiser, when we spend money on the new Wentworth school construction, that's expensed. You budget it as an expense. So different way of looking at things. So the other thing that you would notice here too is we've got debt on the books. So all of the bonds payable show up at the bottom of total liabilities. So when that's received on the fund financial statements, it's a revenue source. So there's a different way of accounting for it. Going into the fund financial statements on pages 41 and 42, so this really mirrors how your internal books look like. The general fund is the general operations of the town and, of course, includes the school as well. We've got other funds that we list out here separately. The Wentworth School construction is listed by itself as well because it is a significant activity last year and this year and next year as well. So all of the funds and operations of the town are accounted for here. And this does tie in with your budget basis, which is on page 44. And so that the budget basis is the general fund. And the thing that you're probably most interested in is what's our fund balance. If you go down to the bottom of the actual column, fund balance for the general fund at the end of 2013 is about $9 million.
That's school and town.
And that is school and town. And so for the year, there was an actual increase in fund balance of about $1,061,000, and that had to do with revenues were better than budget by $756,000. Expenditures were better than budget by about $1,004,000. And you'll see in a couple of slides coming up just a little bit of detail, some historical trend information. There's more information in the financial statements. Page 45 and 46 are what we call the fiduciary funds. So you have again, you're responsible for funds that you can't spend. There are trust funds or scholarships the school maintains for the benefit of the students. And then the agency funds is the money that the students raise. And then, of course, there's also a wealth of information behind these pages as well with the footnotes. There's information on your debt maturities for the next 5 years and thereafter. There's information on other contingent debt. There's information on your cash and investments. So there's definitely a lot of information in here. I don't know if anybody has any questions or thoughts, and we'll just get right into some of the historical information. Also want to point out, too, what's going to be new. So June 30, 2015, there's a new government accounting standard that's going to require the town book the pension liability. Mm-hmm. And that's only going to show up on your government-wide financial statements. There's no requirement that you fund it. That's not, you're not going to be required to fund it, but they want people to see what's know, what's your portion of the Maine public employee retirement system? And, you know, how does that impact the town's financial results? And so, of course, that would include the school teachers as well as the town employees that are eligible to participate in it. It's also thought that that's going to lead to another standard where you've got post-retirement healthcare liability, that that will probably be required to be recorded as well. But I, and I believe, so there'll be some, there should be some information coming out about that in the year we're in, where we'll have some information on that.
This is similar to what the OPEB that we had to do a few years ago.
Correct, correct.
Yep.
Just getting into a few slides with trend analysis here. I've got a slide on the general fund balance of the town for the past 3 years. You can see a steady increase. We were at about $6.5 million in 2011. Now we're at about $9 million for 2013. I know you internally you have a not a policy, but a more of a good guideline or a desire to be at 8.3% of your fund balance as being unrestricted. I think it's you're at about 5.5% or so. So certainly there's a reason to increase fund balance to meet that policy. The next slide just shows the trend in property taxes for the last 3 years. Because there's a pretty good jump in property taxes from 2012 to 2013, from $46 million to about $49 million. You'll see there's you know, the reason for that is a couple places, and you'll see one of them on the next slide being that state education subsidy has been steadily declining for the last 4 or 5 years. So if you're just looking at the trend here, the blue graph shows that state education subsidy wasn't quite $6 million in 2011. Now it's at, I think it's like $4.3 million for 2013. If you're actually to look back to 2009, it was $7 million. So that's gone down. So if you think about that $3 million increase in your tax revenue, that kind of compares pretty well with the amount of money the state has taken away. See the other two categories as well. Excise taxes has come back a little bit. That's been steady. State revenue sharing is about $1 million a year. Looking at what the major expenditures are for the town, education is the largest expenditure. So that education expense went up from $34 million to about $36 million in this current year. And I think, and you'll definitely see from looking at the when we get into a couple of the slides for the school that you know, the school department, at least for the last few years, had been spending down its fund balance. It built it back up this year, but there was a period of 2 or 3 years where they, in order to meet the level of expenditures that were desired, that the fund balance was spent down. Other major expenditures, the other big three, public safety is about $8 million a year. That's gone up a little bit the last few years. Public works is about $6 million now, and debt service is at about $5 million or so. And that debt service doesn't include the school. The school's portion of the debt service is included in its budget for purposes of this analysis. I can move on into the school's financial statements unless there's any questions with the town or any further details. I don't have that too many slides for the school. I think it'll go pretty quick. So the school's financial statements are a lot different than the town's. It's an audit of the school by the department. So we don't have the three levels of accounting like we do with the city or with the town. We've just got a fund financial statement and a budget financial statement. Technically, the school isn't not a legally separate entity. So it doesn't, technically, the debt is in the name of the town. The assets are in the name of the town. It's a department of the town. So that's why the financial statements look different. But you know, we have issued an unmodified or a clean opinion on the school's financial statements as well. So page 5 of the financial statements is the budgetary basis. So you can see the general fund of the school for the year had, see, at the end of the year, we're at $1,270,000 of fund balance. Started the year with $700,000. So there was an increase in fund balance for the year of about $566,000. And a lot of that has to do with expenditures being less than budget by about $1,200,000. But that was also offset by a reduction in the state subsidy by about $400,000. I think the next thing I have is just a slide, just to show the fund balance trend for the next, for the last 3 years. You know, again, like I said, we were, you know, we'd spent down the school fund balance in 2011 to about $500,000. And so it's gradually been built up since, from 2011 to 12 and 13, to where it's at now at about $1.2 million.
I have a question on that. That fund balance in the school department, is there a best practice, like percentage-wise or whatever, that should be held in this type of balance?
With all the schools we do, it's kind of, it's really all over the place. I mean, I've got some that are at, say, 10 or 15%,
mm-hmm.
and we have some that are at a lower amount. So I think at $1.2 million, you're at
2.9.
About 3%. Yeah, 2.9.
I can jump in on that a little bit. The state has a statute on the books that says that school departments shouldn't carry more than 3%.
Okay.
Because they don't want schools to be sitting on funding that comes from... but they've actually waived that in the past, I would say, 4 years, maybe five. When we had the big economic downturn, they said, you know, you guys got to manage how you can manage. You're going to use that fund balance to support your budgeting,
mm-hmm.
so you can retain more than 3%.
And does that sort of coincide with the decrease in subsidies?
It hasn't really been linked to that.
No,
but it has coincided with that. The decrease in subsidy has coincided with the economic downturn, where
sure.
the state is just not getting the income and revenues that they need. So we're all in the same boat together. But we've built it back up to that 2.9%, and that's about where it needs to be from the state's perspective.
I think most of the ones we deal with are probably more kind of in line with, like, the town's policy. They have at least, like, 1 month, say, 1 to 2 months in fund balance. And like Kate said, I mean, the state hasn't been, but they suspended that 3% rule for the last, it's been quite a few years.
I was going to say it's like 5 years now.
Yeah, yeah.
And just to be clear, we'll get into this in more detail at the budget, I'm sure, but we don't budget fund balance. We don't have a, you know, an expense line says fund balance. So that's created either through a function of spending less than you thought, which is good news, or receiving more revenue. And frankly, as budgets get tighter and tighter, at the end of the year, there's not much left over, and revenues were really razor thin on. So
I'm
not seeing windfall on revenue.
No, I'm not asking for that reason. I'm just asking purely accounting.
What's
the best practice?
It's just a point that I didn't want to lose sight of, that this upward trend of fund balance is very good news, because the prior 3 years, you would have seen a reverse trend. And all of that speaks very well for us when we go to the bond rating agencies to show that sort of upward trend. So it's been a conscious effort on our part to try to build that slowly over time.
Yeah, the bond rating agencies, actually, one of the bond rating agencies actually reduced our bond rate because our fund balance, one of the reasons was because our fund balance, we were using it too much. So I'm not sure that we increase our rating again, too, because we're now increasing the trend.
Is the fund balance of school part of the total general fund balance on page 8?
Yes.
And that on page 8 is, you could say that was about 5.2%.
5.5, roughly, at this point. And your stated goal is 8.3.
Okay.
We would never get to our goal.
It would take some time.
If the school was rolled in, the school was managing their general fund balance.
It would take some time. So long as we budget accurately, both on expense and the revenue side, you're not going to see great gains year to year. Probably the single best thing we've done over the last 3 years is stop using it on the town side. That's the quickest way to erode it, obviously, is to start budgeting it as a revenue kind of going forward in the budget. We used that back in the kind of the depths of the recession because it was necessary.
Mm-hmm.
1 year we actually held the tax rate and did it with fund balance.
Yeah.
We're recovering from that, frankly.
Yeah.
But there's an argument to be made. This is taxpayer money, and when times get tough, just like your household budget, you look at what your resources are. And I think it made sense at the time, but now I think we need to buckle down and do a better job of maintaining healthy fund balance.
Part of the reason for using, keeping our fund balance, is in case of any catastrophic condition that might happen, so that, I mean, we're keeping 1 month, essentially, we're trying to keep 1 month's worth of expenditures. If you think about a catastrophe that might happen, and you have to get councils together or school boards together to do whatever they need to do to, you know, authorize the emergency funds, or, you know, keep people working while the like public safety or whatever, you know, 1 month expenditures goes by pretty quick, and during a catastrophe, 1 month goes by pretty quick.
That's it.
So I have, thank you for your time, thank you for having us and having Ashage as your audit firm, thank you.
Thank you.
I guess we're done. Council meeting will be starting at 7:00, so thank you all for showing up.